And now we get to part two.
Is here.
The loudspeaker spoke up and said, "Christianity is stupid."
Greetings, fellow worker slaves, podcasting at 128 kilobits from the Fortress of Squalitude, not far from the Redneck Mecca. This is the Atheist in the Trailer Park podcast. I'm your host, Tucker. Professor Fuzznuts is in my arms. Buddha and Lord Squeakington are in my room. Yes, it's a podcast hosted by a guy and his cats. Get over it. And this is part two of the conversation that I had with Hertzy and Bridget Fitch. And again, I didn't do much of the talking. I let them have most of the discussion, as I felt that was most appropriate. I will say that the conversation didn't stick to just those points, and it went on to various topics that were kind of related. And it starts out a little weird because, as you'll recall, I had some kind of glitch on my end, and lost the connection for a second and then came back, and he sort of meandered a bit, just discussing the connection issue before we got kind of back on topic, and I cut all that out. So it's going to start a little abruptly because we just slowly phased back in. Now for the things going on around here. I'm trying to keep somebody from getting too close to the microphone because he wants to rub up against it for some reason, don't you? Come on, buddy. Come on. So, today's Thursday. I went to work, and sure enough, they did not have things ready for us. As a matter of fact, when I got there, supervisor said to me, "Hey, you want to sign a waiver, or do you want to work for 4 hours? Now, I'm no dummy. I said, I want to work for 4 hours because it didn't matter what I had to do during those 4 hours. I knew if I signed the waiver that there was a very real possibility that I could get a text tomorrow morning saying, you ain't got to work today and you can't come in. So I took my 4 hours. And, yeah, like I said, they weren't done. They had some stuff done. They've got some equipment installed, but it's not nearly ready to run yet. Supposedly, they're going to have it all ready by tomorrow. I'm not seeing how that's possible. We're also short of some essential supplies, so that's going to complicate things as well. And for 4 hours, they had me doing bullshit, basically. That's all there is to it. It was stupid stuff to keep me busy. Some of it was actually kind of productive because I was able to scrub some equipment that hadn't been scrubbed in a long time and really needed it. None of the areas are ones that directly come in contact with food, but they're, you don't want funk building up on the underside of a machine. So, we'll see how tomorrow goes. Like I said, they've told the contractors they got to have everything done by the morning. I don't see that happening. I just do not see that happening at all. In other news around here, did not get the roof sealed. Ran into a problem with the cleaner. None of the stores close to me stock the stuff that I've used in the past. And I found some stuff at Tractor Supply that would, I thought would work. So I got up this when I was off and started cleaning the roof, because you got to clean it before you can reseal it. And the stuff did a good job, but it just, there wasn't enough in the container to do very much of the roof. So I went and got some more, bought all they had, which was 2 gallons. And I figured, well, I'll just hit the spots that I think are most likely to leak, which are the seams on the roof. I mean, there's other places that could leak, but the seams are definitely the spots most likely to have a leak. And I still didn't really have enough to get it all done. I got most of them done with that. And as I got to looking at the roof in spots, I'm like, staring at it, and it's like, I can't tell if I actually put 2 coats on this section of the roof the last time I sealed it or not. And if I only put 1 coat on there, I need to put a 2nd coat on there. And I've only got the 1 bucket of sealant. And that won't be enough for the whole roof. So I'm like, okay, I'm not going to buy more of the stuff that I've been using, assuming that they had restocked at Tractor Supply, which I had no way of knowing. So I ordered stuff that I normally use off of Amazon, and I was scheduled to be delivered here today, and I was hoping that when I got off, it would be here and that would give me enough time to get up there and reseal the roof. No. It didn't show up until about half an hour ago, and it's dark now, so there's no way I can get up there and scrub the roof. So we'll see how things go this week. And if I'm able to get up there and do it, it all depends on what my work schedule is. Which I have any fucking clue as to what it's going to be. I mean, they had us sign the waiver, they asked people to sign a waiver, so that tells me they're not planning on having us work on Sunday. But that doesn't mean anything. Because if we were going to work on Sunday, then we wouldn't have had to sign a waiver. We'd still be getting the 32 hours they're supposed to be able to get. And they could only give me 4. So that means they're expecting to have overtime later on this week. We'll see. We shall see. In other news, I got a little extra donation for my car fund, which is good. So I appreciate that. Still got a ways to go, but I'm pushing the halfway point, so that's good. And when I'm off next, that's when I'm going to dig into all the paperwork about stuff like the insurance and getting my license back. It's been a little, when I've been inside, somebody has been rather bothersome, and it's not the four-legged friend in my arms right now who's been bothersome. It's that time, I guess, where somebody's got to be just agitated. So we'll see how that goes. I will keep you posted. The show notes are basically going to be the same. I will add a link in the show notes to an episode of the It Could Happen Here podcast, because they just did an episode dedicated to dealing with the fact that a lot of people now live in a state that they can't get an abortion, and it has advice on how to do that. And this really, really is just kind of a minor thing, but the population of Texas and Afghanistan are pretty close. I think Afghanistan has a few million more people than Texas, or it might be the other way around, but they're within like 10 million in terms of population. I don't know how that translates into size. You know, geographic size, but it's like, wow. Okay. I think that's enough, as somebody is deprived and needs attention, don't you, you little boy? Don't you? Yes, you're a pretty boy. So let's get to Hertzy and Bridget and a little bit of me talking about abortion and a few other things. Oh, I'm not really sure if this is relevant or not, but Bridget actually, now that I think about it, is definitely relevant. I need to point out that Bridget has been very active in politics in her area. She was even a chair on Pete Buttigieg's first mayoral run. So that tells you how kind of plugged in she is to politics in Indiana. All right, so let's get to Bridget and Hertzy.
Personal responsibility only goes one way with pregnancy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, let's not go after the guy stealthing. Let's go after the girl for, I don't know,
having sex.
Yeah, having sex, missing her, you know, missing her pill.
We'll see. Women and females are not supposed to have sex. Men are supposed to have all the sex that they can possibly get. And that's okay. But for the women, no, it's not, because that makes them dirty sluts.
Yeah.
Or something. I don't know. I mean, you know, even Judaism is not very strict when it comes to abortion rights or anything like that. You know, they think that the woman who is pregnant, or, you know, the person who is pregnant, whoever is pregnant, you know, has precedence over everything else.
Well, they don't, if I recall correctly,
they don't consider life until the first breath.
Yeah, that's where I was going with that. It's like, I think it's that, and there's hospitals and stuff, I think, where there's more socialized medicine, where if a child is born premature, there are limits.
Mm-hmm. It's what they will do. Know?
And I get it.
Yeah.
It sucks, but...
Well, I mean, having worked for insurance companies and healthcare and things like that, you know, I have seen how much it costs to have a sick baby that's born at, yeah, say 23 or 24 weeks, and the millions of dollars that those bills come to put a sick baby in the NICU for a couple of months. And, you know, before the, you know, ACA was passed into law and insurance companies used to have lifetime limits, you know, some of those babies would max out their lifetime insurance limits, you know, at 2 months of age. They were done. They could not get coverage. No one would underwrite them. No company would ever pay another penny. They were just done.
Yeah.
And if we ever get, quote-unquote, Obamacare repealed, we're going to go right back to that. You know, some, you know, places had, like, a lifetime coverage of $1 million. Some of them had, like, $100,000. It just depended on, you know, the insurance company and the plan that you had. And we could go back to that. And all of these people who were diagnosed with COVID, I hate to tell them, but if pre-existing conditions are ever a thing again, everything that you have wrong with you will be considered pre-existing just because you had COVID.
I'm just going to bask in the schadenfreude of that for 2 seconds before, you know, the reality of how awful that is hits me. Okay. And actually what's funny is Minnesota actually had protection from that in 87? No, it wasn't 87. It was late 80s, early 90s. So I remember when the ACA was starting to go up, I was like, wait, that's not a thing everywhere else?
No, it's not. Mm-mm. Shit.
And the ACA still has it, but it is a higher one than what a lot of people had before. And because I can, when the whole thing was being debated, I can remember this guy bitching about, well, now they've got limits on your health insurance. And I said, you've never read your health insurance policy. There's always been a limit there. You've just never known that.
And it's one of those, it's like, oh, go ahead.
Yeah, I knew it. I mean, I've been working, you know, with this or in this industry since 1997. Yes, I've been around a minute. And, you know, I remember people hitting their caps that I worked with because, you know, their kid had leukemia. Or they had to have, you know, a bone marrow transplant, and boom, they hit their lifetime limit, and insurance was not going to pay another penny for anything ever again. Yeah. I remember.
Yeah, because
I know people that happened to.
Yeah, I remember people desperately who had insurance desperately raising money because they needed an organ transplant, and their insurance was not going to cover the full cost.
Yeah. And how much you want to bet they have not updated those amounts to look at costs and such, and making sure that it goes up with the cost of stuff. I bet all of them have not done that on purpose.
No, of course. Of course.
I mean, heck, you look at dental insurance, and it's like the stuff that insurance will cover is years out of date.
Oh, yeah, and the amount they pay, like the last time I had, I could afford to go to the dentist, you know, they did all this work, and they said, you need a root canal. And I said, well, how much is that going to be? And they says, they looked at me, and she goes, oh, well, after insurance, and she named an amount that was literally half my monthly income. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, I can't afford that.
Yeah.
There's just no way. I mean, you know, I'm sure some people can afford half their month's income with no problem, but I am not one of them.
Yeah.
Oh, hell no.
So.
Well, I mean, you know, Aaron gets his dental work done in Mexico because he can't afford to have it done in Texas.
Yeah. I don't know if you've seen that meme that says, you know, if you need a hip replacement, it's cheaper to go to Spain and pay at cash to have it done than have it done in the U.S.?
Yeah, it is. I can vouch for that.
But our health care is so great.
Yeah, I mean,
it's so overpriced, and most people don't have access to it.
It would
and
be...
I cannot tell you the number of people that I saw file for bankruptcy last year, well, actually within the last 4 years, because of medical bills.
Yeah.
I cannot tell you how many I saw, and most of them were in Illinois, granted, but it was ridiculous.
And it makes me, it's so frustrating because everyone keeps talking about how socialized medicine will cost so much, and it's like, really, it won't.
Yeah.
It'll actually be cheaper for everybody.
Yeah.
And my favorite is, well, I don't want to pay for somebody else. I'm like,
you already
first
are.
Off, what makes you a little goddamn fucking snowflake? And secondly, there are so many diseases and things that you can just randomly get. You know, cancer doesn't care if you're overweight or fit, and actually neither does cholesterol, as we've been learning. So,
I mean, anybody that tested positive for COVID at all, asymptomatic or not, you know, they're saying now that at least 30% of the people, if not more, have long COVID.
Mm-hmm.
And because it literally attaches to your ACE2 receptors, which are in every organ of your body, it can cause anything.
Right.
I mean, it damages all of your organs.
Right.
There's going to be people drop dead from pulmonary embolisms that didn't even know they were ever infected. They're just going to drop dead in a few years, or you're going to have kids that fall over dead in gym class because of that. You know,
but you know, the vaccine is deadly.
Well, sorry. You know, it has these microchips in them, and, you know, Bill Gates, and, you know, and I feel like that, I feel like I got ripped off because I didn't get this incredible 5G reception. I just got Windows 98 and blue screen to death. That's all.
Well, and here's the thing, because I said earlier that I had the next one on, which is a long-ass chip that they put in your arm. So, you know, in my opinion, it's a wonderful device. I would definitely suggest it for anybody who is looking for that kind of thing. It is a hormonal, so. But I've had a chip inserted in.
That's a big-ass needle.
Well, yeah, it's like, you can't do that with the thing. I remember hearing like a chunk, and I was just like, I am so glad I have Novocaine in that arm, because that sounds like it would have been painful.
Yeah, I mean, if they were doing anything big enough to have a chip, you would know. You would see it.
Mm-hmm. I could feel it. In fact, after they put it in, you have to verify and feel your arm. It was always really funny to get any other people to touch it, though, because they were always just like, oh my god!
Well, this is kind of, you know, out from left field, but I find it kind of funny that these males are so afraid of the Pfizer vaccine, yet they'll trust Pfizer to give them the little blue pill. You know, yeah. Pfizer's getting the money one way or the other.
Yeah.
And the thing about it is, if you happen to have erectile dysfunction from COVID, which, you know, can happen, taking Viagra after that can kill you.
Can we get a variant that causes ED in just the people who refuse to take the vaccine because of conspiracy theories? Is it possible?
With the rate of mutations for people who are immunocompromised and can't clear it, it might happen.
The problem is that I feel bad for the immunocompromised and I don't want them to suffer.
I know. I just
damn you, morals.
I just came out of working for, you know, hematology, oncology, so yeah. I mean, I feel that. And those were some of the first people that I started, you know, having as COVID patients. And there was one that I will never, ever, ever forget. It was, I can't mention, you know, because of HIPAA, you know, anything about them that would identify them or anything, but this person went into ICU in March 2020 and finally came out of ICU in January of this year, only to be discharged to like a long-term care facility and die a month later. But this person, you know, was intubated on a ventilator for months and then put on ECMO twice to try to give their heart and lungs a break to recover some. But, yeah, I mean, 10 months in an ICU. Can you imagine what kind of shape that person would be in after that? Dying would have been a lot more merciful.
Yeah.
And then after all of that, to die anyway, I mean, it was just, and so people who would tell me that, oh, it's just the flu and all that, I would just click on them and say, I know better. I've seen too much of it. I know better.
Yeah, it's a tragedy, and we really have, everybody has to get busy.
Yes.
They've got to, but, you know, even some of my former coworkers were anti-masks. A lot of them haven't had the vaccine, things like that, and at first, you know, they were requiring all of us to wear a mask at work and following, you know, CDC guidelines and things. And I think the CDC really screwed up when they, you know, said that if you've been vaccinated, you don't have to wear a mask anymore. That was before Delta. I mean, there was no way they could have known. But I think that they were too hasty to make that decision and should not have done it. It caused a lot more harm.
Yeah.
But the day that my employer decided that we didn't need to wear masks anymore, that it was optional, and I was the only person who was wearing a mask, and all these other people should have known better, I quit. I put in my 2 weeks' notice and thought about it over the weekend and said, screw this, I'm not going back because I'm not going to die. It's not worth it.
Yeah.
And I've been vaccinated, but I'm high risk. And my husband, unfortunately, is at the age to where, you know, with the hospitals being full here, if something were to happen to him, whether it's car accident, stroke, heart attack, whatever, because of his age, that he would not get a bed.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's 72, so we already know that they would go, no, it would have to go to someone younger. Just because that's how triage works. So, we've already had that discussion. You know, we had it a while back that, you know, our preference is if we have to be admitted for anything, we don't want to die alone in isolation, so we'd rather die here at home. And it's just awful that we've had that conversation, but we've had to.
Yeah. I know. I mean.
And I have this horror of my daughter coming down with something like appendicitis and dying for lack of a bed. And realistically, that can happen. I was just talking to one of my friends before I got on Skype here. And one of her coworkers almost died last week from appendicitis.
I saw a news article. Some guy died of gallstones because he couldn't get gallbladder surgery.
Yep.
And, I mean, that's outpatient now.
Mm-hmm.
And, but they just could not squeeze him in. There was some guy, I don't know if it's still the case or not, but he had 6 bullets in him and they couldn't operate on him because there were no, they just couldn't do it. They had, you know, they don't have the facilities because they're all tied up.
Yeah, that's all that.
But hey, let's take some more of this anti-parasitic and run her around screaming in people's faces. Yep,
yeah.
Yep. That will solve all of the problems. It's just one more step until the big turnover happens or whatever bullshit Q cultists are doing.
Yeah, I've said that Biden just needs to come out and tell people, no, taking large amounts of cyanide will not prevent COVID and let nature take its course. It will solve so many problems.
I, as much as that would, it's like I've go through the, what is it called again? God damn it. My brain is all over the place. Q casualties.
Yeah.
On Reddit. And it is so hard to hear those stories. Some of them are scary because it's, you know, it's like we've been married for 22 years. Now he's saying we have to divorce, or he's, you know, either the vaccine or him. You know, other ones are, you know, my mom says I can't get the vaccine. How can I do it?
Yeah, they fired the head of the state's Department of Health. Simply because they had on the government state website, you know, that kids can get any vaccine they want without their parents' permission if you're above a certain age. You know, and I mean, this is like high school kids, so.
And oh, yeah.
They fired her for that, and it's like, you people are you know.
Yeah.
It's,
yeah.
They're deliberately creating a cognitive dissonance in people and turning, you know, politics into even more of a religion than it already was.
I mean, let's
be honest, because Trumpism is a religion and it's, you know,
it's cultists. I am scared for when Trump dies. Because if you look at the QAnon conspiracies, anybody who dies a natural death has not died. Like, McCain is allegedly still alive or has been hung by a military tribunal, but he didn't die of a brain tumor the way, you know.
Yeah.
would be the most likely.
Yeah. Wow.
Well, and they, I mean, they still think some dude is John F. Kennedy Jr.
Yeah. So my worry with Trump is when Trump dies, it's just, it's going to implode and explode at the same time because they cannot handle the idea of somebody having a natural death. And Trump, of course, is the epitome of perfection. So he could never die. Ever. Despite the fact that he's, what, 80?
He's in his 70s, late 70s.
It almost would actually be better for him to die by somebody assassinating him. Because then the conspiracy is already there.
Yeah.
It's just hard to wrap my mind around what has happened to people. They have lost their minds.
Yeah, yeah. And I have deep concerns that Biden and the others are not doing enough to mitigate the damage. If we actually have a roaring, rip-roaring economy, a lot of the shit goes away because people are too busy doing other stuff to think about things like this. But when you've got people who can't really do anything because they got no money, they tend to sit around and do screwy shit.
I was going to say, it's one of those that's like, part of me agrees, but then the other part of me is like, I'm not sure. I think it's a mix.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, people will quit their job so that they can be online and following the Q people, their Q friends, even more. It's very insulating. Like a cult.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I don't know if having enough money to do stuff would be enough.
It would mitigate some of the effects, I think.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, well, like has been shown, there are 12 people responsible for the bulk of COVID disinformation out there. And, you know, if...
Why haven't we arrested them?
Yeah. If you can, you know, break that spread up a little bit, it helps a tremendous amount. Unfortunately, Facebook just doesn't really care because Zuckerberg wants to be a Roman emperor.
Yeah. He does realize what happened to most of the Roman emperors, right?
Yeah, but he wants to be Augustus Caesar.
Yeah, that didn't end well either. Also, he does not have whatever machismo Caesar had.
You saw the photo that he put on social media for the 4th of July?
Nope.
Okay. He's on an electric wakeboard thing. You know, which is, it's like a surfboard, but it's got a motor and it, right? And he's waving and holding a giant American flag.
Okay, great.
And it's like, you have no idea how stupid this makes you look. And it's one of those things that it was not just a spur-of-the-moment thing. It had to be carefully planned. Because the photograph was taken from a pursuit boat. You know, he had this big, huge flag, and he somehow thought it would make him look good. But there's, I guess, 4 episodes of Behind the Bastards on Zuckerberg. I've only heard 2 of them, and I already didn't like the guy, and it made me like him even less.
So are we going to spoil for Zuckerberg what happened to Augustus Caesar? Because I really want to do that. we could give him, yeah, we could use props, we could really, I'm not saying, you know. Oh, it's a good thing that, I do not take legal advice from a podcast. Pretty sure. I would give people an aneurysm. All right. So we've talked a lot about some very depressing and horrifying things. Can we talk about some action things that people can do?
Well, there is, which I will be putting in that show notes, there is that lovely list that you gave of all the various sites that will help in, you know, dealing with this.
Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, you know, donating to organizations like NARAL, Planned Parenthood. And I know for a fact that there is an underground railroad system to get women out of places like Texas, who need, you know, either need an abortion or just need to get the hell out of that shithole state.
Yep.
But they're obviously very cagey as to everything, so you would need to be involved in the, you know, women's organizations for a while before they would trust you with that.
Yeah.
But that would be a good thing.
I'm not sure if this is on the list I gave you, because I kind of gave you like a link to a list that somebody else had already put together, so props to that person. But plancpills.org?
Yeah, that's not on that list, but I have that because Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez tweeted that out.
Yes. I think that's part of what they're trying to do is help get those kind of pills to people who need them. And, you know, it's amazing what technology can do, because you can just sit at home and do your thing.
Yeah. I have
been, at least that's the plan.
Yeah, I have been told, I do not know, that there are some fairly common medications that you can get that are, you know, I forget what, I don't know what their intended use is, but they also double as abortificants, and it's pretty easy to get them, you know, for... In other words, you don't actually have to have the medical condition they're designed to treat to be able to get them, because it's one of those, you know, I'm not going to say it's an allergy medicine, but it's like an allergy medication in that, well, everybody can have this and things like that. But I don't know what they are. There is, and this again will go in the show notes, and it might be paywalled, so I will pull some stuff out. But there is, it's a 1989 article from the Washington Post that, talks about, you know, what women were doing to have safe abortions during, you know, before Roe v. Wade happened. And, I'm sure this stuff that talks about, like, there's an instructional video that was made. I'm sure that's out there somewhere on YouTube or Daily Motion or one of those other sites.
Yes, there's also a book. Crap. I don't know how much of this has how to, but it is a good book, and it was post Roe. Oh, here we go. Handbook for Post-Roe America by Robin Marty. Well, I think actually it's local to Minnesota. But the end of Roe versus Wade is coming. How will you prepare? So, good book.
Yeah. And just, you know, hey, if you know any women in Texas, and just let them know, hey, if you need to take a trip out of state for whatever reason, I will be more than happy to put you up. Of course, that won't do them any good coming here, because Tennessee is just about as bad as Texas.
Well, I think Tennessee also has trigger laws, too, if I'm not mistaken.
I don't know, but I know we can't. I know that there's almost no place to get an abortion here in Tennessee. Because, Jeebus.
Yeah, same thing with Arkansas, too. I think they have maybe one clinic left in Little Rock.
Yeah. And, I mean, that's another thing that we ought to point out. Just because you've got a clinic doesn't mean you can access it. Because not only is it hard for you to get, you know, it may be hard for you to get there, but I know in some states there's a 72-hour waiting period. So you have to go to the clinic, say, I want this thing out of me, and they say, okay, come back in 3 days.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a huge burden because it's hard to, you know, when you're poor, it's hard to take time off work, let alone travel.
Oh, yeah.
You know, so, and I mean, that Arkansas is not the only state like that. I know for a fact.
Minnesota gets really big when you start looking at, like, how long it takes to get to the cities from, you know, the Iron Range.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And that's...
Heck, at that point, you might as well cross the border.
Yeah, I wonder what the situation in Canada is like.
I've heard from some people that they're sick and tired of us saying how great they are, because they're like, we have a ton of white ring assholes, too!
Yeah, I know, but they're... I mean... Okay, what's his name? Doug Ford?
Yeah.
He's actually come out in favor of mask mandates. And, I mean, that guy is... he's not exactly their version of Trump. That's his dead brother. But he's pretty darn close.
Yeah, but you have to look at Alberta province. Alberta is their version of Texas.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know somebody actually in Canada, and every so often he'll pop up on my thing, and I'm just like, oh, dude, he's got a Confederate flag, he's pro-Trump, and I'm just like, oh, you don't want this.
Yeah, you
my
really
sister,
don't.
Yeah, my sister she's still active military. She was active the whole time, and the whole time I was just like, okay, let's not start a war, please.
Yeah, Alberta has decided that, you know, they don't want any mask mandates and all that stuff, too. I mean, they just...
Jeez.
They're the more conservative part of Canada, not where I would want to go.
Aren't they also the ones who have been trying to separate from the rest of Canada the whole time?
No, that's Quebec.
No, that was Quebec.
Okay.
Yeah.
Whoa.
But let's just say that when my renewed passport came in the mail 3 weeks ago, there was a huge sigh of relief. I mean, but you still can't drive, you know, travel across the border, you know, to get into Canada if you're driving. You can fly, but you can't really drive. But it's one thing that I've kept in the back of my mind is if all hell breaks loose here, at least, you know, I have friends that live, you know, sort of near Toronto that will, you know, offer me at least a couch or a spare bedroom until I can get on my feet and figure out what I'm going to do with my life.
Yeah. I have been told that there are large sections of the Canadian border with the U.S. in places like Montana that if you're not paying attention and you make the wrong turn, you suddenly find yourself in Canada, and there's no border checkpoint.
Yeah, but if you wind up in Canada illegally and then you try to immigrate there later, then they won't let you.
Yeah, well.
So that's not really something that you want to do. You want to cross legally if at all possible, unless they open it up to where we can declare asylum, which probably won't happen because the Canadians are too smart for that. They know that they don't want us. They're like, yeah, you just keep your stuff down there.
Yeah.
You know, they're like the apartment over at the top of the meth lab. They just, yeah, they know better.
Yeah, but we hit a civil war, and they're gonna open. They're gonna have to.
We'll see.
Yeah, well, because if they don't, then it's gonna get ugly.
Well, yeah, I mean it's going to get ugly, but yeah, their population is not that much. It's only what, 30 million people in the whole country?
Yeah.
And there's over 330 million of us. I mean, and I don't blame them. I wouldn't want us either.
Yeah, I know. But if my thought is if we get a Trump 2.0, somebody who's actually knows what they're doing and is a fascist, one of the things they'll do is they'll invade Mexico because nobody in the world will object. There'll be a lot of embarrassed throat clearing, but nothing serious will happen. If we officially invade Canada, that's when things will start to get ugly. So Canada will probably try to do everything to keep us from, keep our military from invading them.
Yeah.
So, and if, I don't know how the U.S. government would react to them if Americans in the middle of a civil war start fleeing to Canada.
I don't know.
I don't know. I'm just...
If it looks like it's going to go that direction, I'm not going to wait until it actually does, but, depending on what happens in 2022, if that goes sideways, I'm gone.
Yeah.
And I've been keeping an eye on their, critical shortage list as far as, getting, expedited visas for jobs that they don't have people to fill. And making sure that I have something on that, skill set to fit. And I'll watch that thing like a hawk.
Unfortunately, I am of an age where it's difficult. A lot of countries wouldn't let me in, even if I do have critical skills.
Age is a thing, and I'm probably close to your age.
Because I looked at New Zealand, because they need machinists, which I am. Unfortunately, if you're over 52, which I am, they won't let you in. There's ways to get there, but obviously you can come as a tourist and things like that, but to settle there, you have to find somebody willing to marry you. And I don't know how I transport my cats halfway around the planet.
I don't know, but people are so concerned about us down here that I've even had a couple of friends that live near Vancouver that are single, and they're, older women that are, I would say late 50s, and, they've even said, if you need a place to come, we can have a sham marriage and you can come here, come stay with me. And my husband's like, well, that's what it takes. You have my blessing if it comes to that.
Yeah.
And I've got to get my daughter out of here. I've got to. For her sake. I'm not worried about getting pregnant myself because that's not possible anymore. But, I'm worried about her.
Yeah. Well, I'm just... It's bad enough to be a woman in general, and this kind of thing only makes it even worse. Because of the way our society is.
Yeah. I mean, I had cancer 12 years ago, so I don't have to worry about, pregnancy or anything like that. But people that I love and care about do have to worry about it. and I have to fight for them.
Yeah.
But if it looks like there's no way to fight it anymore and it's, you know, too late and we have Trump 2.0 and their, you know, takeover or hijacking of the country is successful, I'm out of here.
Yeah.
I'm not going to stay and fight when there's no chance in hell that we can win.
Well, I've known too many people who fled civil wars to even want to hang around.
Well, I definitely wouldn't want to hang around here in a red area.
Yeah.
There's no way.
Yeah, and
I mean, I would prefer to be someplace like Vermont, but I can't afford housing there.
Most of my neighbors are Latino. So I'm sure when the rednecks decide to come and burn them out, they won't pay too much attention to who lives where and just start torching every place.
Well, most of my neighbors are y'all Cata.
Even though I live in a trailer park, most of my neighbors are Latino. I mean, I got a couple of y'all Catas, and then I got some I don't knows, but I've got mine are Latino, so I'm sure they, you know, bubbles will be coming for them if they think they can get away with it. And Hertzy is frozen on my screen. Is she frozen on yours?
Nope.
I shouldn't be frozen. I should be just not moving a lot.
Yeah. Well, you were frozen and now you're moving, so I know.
Yeah, I'm just kind of sitting here because I'm just like, and the area that I want to move to is actually a fair amount of Hmong, Laos, actually fairly diverse area. Not saying that there won't be an allocated supremacist assholes, because they can appear anywhere. But yeah.
We're full of them here, you know, plus the evangelicals.
Oh yeah.
We have one charter school in town. And they have an IB program, which I think is wonderful to have. And, mm-hmm. you know, with that, you can go to school in Europe if you want to. I mean, anything. And that school, I mean, people here have been trying to close it for years because having, an international baccalaureate, it's New World Order and blah, blah, blah.
Oh, my God.
I mean, seriously. They're that far gone. And I, when the shit hits the fan, I don't want to be anywhere near those people.
No.
Unfortunately, everybody in this neighborhood knows how we voted because I don't know who got access to the records, how they did it, but someone did and mailed everyone in this neighborhood. They had names, addresses, and how they voted. That is intimidating as hell.
Obviously there'll be differences.
That's supposed to be private, but they...
I
was floored.
I know someone who would know some of the legalities involved in all of that. I will talk to them.
Because I'm going to say, that sounds illegal as shit.
Yeah.
It is very illegal, and that's voter intimidation, and somebody... here, either at the local or state level, got access to that information. And like I said, when we got it in the mail and I opened it up, my jaw hit the floor.
Yeah.
I mean, I understand that pollsters and things will have access to, like, you know, your political affiliation because they know who to canvass and, you know, get out the vote efforts and all that other stuff. But to put names, addresses, and who they voted for and to send it to all of the neighbors, I mean, that, and I don't know if it was just our neighborhood, if it was this county, I don't know. I don't interact with these people any more than I have to.
Yeah, but they shouldn't know who you voted for.
No.
Yeah, but they knew.
So.
And that is frightening.
Yeah.
Yeah. I had a weird phone call today. I got, it was a local number, so I answered it, and there was somebody doing the poll, and they had my first name wrong, So I was like, you know, and they're like, is 2K there? And I says, I'm sorry, you've got the wrong number. And they're like, well, are you a registered voter? I'm doing a poll. And I said, yes, I am. And so I gave them, they didn't ask for my name. They asked for my zip code and a few other, you know, general things like that to establish roughly where I lived. And then they started, you know, they asked me, you know, like my age, if I was married, and if I had kids, and how old my kids were if I had any. And I, you know, when I told them I don't have any kids, they said, okay, thank you, that's all our questions. You know, so there was something odd with that. I had, I don't remember how many years ago now it was, but I had a weird poll call me, and they were trying to reach the person who had the number I have before me, who, bizarrely enough, has the same last name as me. And I explained, no, that's not her number, you know, that she's not here. And they're like, okay, well, let's ask you these questions. And it's like, okay, because we're doing a poll. And I realized quickly on that, you know, the poll was focused on Nashville. Well, I can't, you know, I'm outside of the Nashville city limits. I'm not in the same county, so I can't vote on any of these issues. And they were aggressively trying to find out how I was going to vote on this or how I was going to vote on that. And it's like, I don't live there. I can't vote on these things. So, it was like, that's really weird. So I think that was, you know, somebody trying to do vote manipulation or voter intimidation. But I don't know. And I'm just going to throw this out there because I forgot about this. The governor of Texas claims that Elon Musk backs the abortion ban. And when somebody asked Elon about it, he said, I would rather not talk politics.
Why would he think that Elon Musk backing it would do anything?
Well, because Elon Musk has a cult following.
That's, I mean, that's true, but it's one of those where it's like,
And Elon, you know, famously rechartered all his stuff in Texas because he was tired of dealing with the liberal politics of California. Actually, he was tired of paying taxes in California.
Yeah, he's one of the very, very, very few people who actually does that. The number of people who leave because of a tax thing is so tiny.
Yeah, and he didn't really leave. He just had his mail forwarded to Texas, basically. But yeah, I certainly would not be buying a... I mean, if it... I don't know why Musk said, oh, I don't want to talk politics. He may be afraid that Texas will fucking... but boy, if I was in the market to buy a Tesla, I'd be reconsidering it based on that. But there's no way I'll ever be able to afford a Tesla, so...
Yeah.
So, that's...
I don't know. I mean, and I just... Abbott's probably going to get reelected. And I don't understand it. It's like your politicians are deliberately trying to kill you.
Well,
you would think that that would be bad.
I saw an article the other day that said his popularity is dropping. Whether or not this whether or not this abortion thing will be enough to fix that, I don't know. But
also add in the voting issues that he's introducing as well with this.
Yeah.
Well, and the COVID issue and the whole power grid failure because it's too hot or too cold issue. I would think killing your constituents is just not a good look. But I guess I'm wrong.
They It's like a suicide cult.
Yeah. Yeah. It definitely is. It definitely is.
Because, I mean, the city of Austin, I love.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But there's no way I would move to Texas, ever. And I wish there was some way to take Austin and relocate it.
Yeah.
That's like put a wall around it or something.
That's like me, Louisiana, and New Orleans. I love New Orleans.
Yeah.
Rest of Louisiana is scary as shit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's... There's a couple of very nice cities in Texas where they're definitely liberal. Same is true of Louisiana. Somewhat true of Tennessee. We've got real problems. And I don't know what the solution is. I'm definitely, once I get some things sorted out, hopefully going to be bugging out of this state to one that's more liberal for various reasons.
Minnesota could use all of the more liberal votes to help keep us liberal-ish, at least.
Yeah, well, I have to be thinking about the public health system because I have to find a way to get somebody into treatment. And it's almost impossible here.
Minnesota You Care is kind of like a socialized thing for under a certain income.
Right, but the problem that I have is here, because I'm not a relative, I can't invoke the Baker Act. And there's no way to get her to agree to treatment because she would have to accept that she is schizophrenic. She's not going to do that. I suspect when she gets medicated that would be an easier discussion to have, but of course, you know, you can't get her medicated unless she admits that she's schizophrenic. She won't admit that she's schizophrenic until she's probably medicated. Because people I know who are schizophrenic who are medicated, in most cases, they're all like, I love my medication. It is, you know, it's so helpful. But, like, one guy I know who's on it took a near-fatal car accident after being up for 4 days straight, and the only reason he agreed to do it was because the alternative was prison. Judge made him a deal. You take this medication, you don't go to prison. He said, okay, I don't need it. I'll take it. And, I mean, you'd think he was a gospel preacher hearing him talk about how much he loves it. So, that gives me hope that if I can get her on medication, she'll be okay. And I don't, you know, because her family's not taking care of her. You know. So I've got to go someplace where there's a good social support network that I can easily get her into without her being rejected. She doesn't even like the idea of going on food stamps or anything like that because she has PTSD because of how her mother treated her and her mother and all that stuff. So if she goes on food stamps or welfare, then she's forced to admit that she's got the same problems as her mother, and she doesn't want to do that because she's got PTSD because her mother was so cruel to her. And if we lived in a country with socialized medicine, just getting her into the doctor would be enough. The doctor would realize, oh, she's got real problems here. Have this. But we don't. So
that's it for this episode of the Atheist in the Trailer Park podcast. You can subscribe to the show on iTunes. It's also on Stitcher, and most of the episodes are on YouTube. Follow the show on Twitter at TParkAtheist, and it's on Facebook at facebook.com/trailerparkatheist. You can email me at trailerparkatheist@gmail.com. Show notes can be found at tparkatheist.blogspot.com. If you happen to like the podcast, please rate it on iTunes. If you'd like to donate to support the podcast, there's a donate button on the show notes page. You can also support the show on Patreon at patreon.com/TNTucker.
With the podcast, there's a donate button on the show notes page. You can support it via Patreon at patreon.com/TNTucker. Thanks for listening.
Say goodnight, Fuzznuts.
All I know is this violates every canon of respectable broadcasting.
Damned cat.